This is the story of Turkish Airlines Flight 726. On the 3rd of March 2015, a Turkish Airlines A330 was on its way from Istanbul to the Nepali city of Kathmandu. The plane took off from Istanbul at 12:03 a.m. Nepalese time. This was going to be a long flight, and the plane had 224 passengers and 11 crew members on board. At 5:47 a.m., the plane tried contacting Kathmandu control, but they got no response. They did this till about 5:56 a.m. As it turns out, Kathmandu control was not operating at this time. The plane was under the control of Varanasi control, and the plane was descending down to 25,000 feet. At 6 a.m., the airport opens and they make contact with Kathmandu control. Kathmandu lets the pilots know that the visibility at the airport was 100 meters or 328 feet, and due to weather conditions, the airport was closed for now. At 6:07 a.m., the crew requests permission to proceed direct to Simara due to some turbulence in the area. ATC agrees, and they were to descend and maintain 21,000 feet and to then hold at Simara. At 6:50 a.m., ATC had an update for the crew. Visibility had now improved to 1,000 meters or 3,200 feet. They asked the crew for their next step. The crew wants to conduct a radio navigation approach onto runway 02. Soon afterward, they were ready to make their approach at 7:09 a.m. Kathmandu Tower cleared flight 726 in. Their landing was a go. They had a slight wind coming in from 100 degrees at 3 knots. All was well, but they never got a visual on the airport or the runway. Flight 726 carried out a missed approach. They were asked to go to the Rattan waypoint and to hold via Manri while maintaining 10,500 feet. At 7:28 a.m., the crew asked for a weather update. This time, the weather had improved a bit. They had a visibility of 3,000 meters or 9,800 feet, a few clouds at 1,000 feet, scattered clouds at 2,000 feet, and broken clouds at 10,000 feet. Attempt number two was already looking better. They were going to attempt a radio navigation approach onto runway 02 again. ATC asked them to report when they reached the Rattan waypoint. The tower clears the plane in, and they had a 4-knot wind coming in from 160 degrees. At 7:42 a.m., the tower asked the crew if they had the runway in sight. They say that they don't, but they're pushing ahead with the approach. As they say this, they were at 880 feet above the terrain. The plane kept on descending. When they were at 783 feet, the pilots asked ATC if the lights were on. ATC said that the runway lights are as bright as they could get. The plane kept descending. They were now 14 feet above the ground and the pilots flared the airplane. The plane touched down, but something was wrong. The plane missed the runway by a bit. The plane landed on the left shoulder of the runway instead of the center line. The left main undercarriage was off the runway and the right undercarriage was on the runway. The nose gear gives out and the plane drags its nose along the runway. Eventually, the plane departed the runway entirely. The engines dragged along the runway as the tires on the left landing gear came free. At 7:45 a.m., Kathmandu Tower asked if the plane had landed, and the pilots radioed for emergency vehicles. At 7:55 a.m., everyone was safely evacuated from the airplane. No one was injured, and all aboard walked away from the crash. One of the first things that the investigators looked at was the weather. They knew that the weather, the visibility in particular, was so bad that it warranted a go-around. So they talked to the pilots to know what they saw. The pilot said that they had a visual with the approach lights at the runway. The pilot said that as they came in, they lost visual with the runway for a bit, and as they were about to declare a missed approach, the runway came into view once again. But the investigators aren't entirely convinced. They turned to CCTVs all around the airport and it confirmed what they thought. The visibility was almost zero. In fact, the visibility was worse now than when they had their first go-around. They talked to the pilots of the plane that was taxiing on the ground as the plane landed. They too say that the visibility was almost zero. It seems as if the pilots had gone ahead with the landing when they should not have. RNAV approaches should be abandoned if you cannot make visual contact with the runway. The investigators listened to the CVR to see what they could glean from it. They listened as the pilots made their approach. As they made their approach, 4 seconds before the minimum's call out, the pilot monitoring says, "It will appear when we descend below." The pilot flying was knowingly breaking a cardinal rule of aviation. Then they hear the plane make an automated minimum call out, to which the pilot flying responded, "Continue until 300 feet." Had they had the runway in sight, they should have responded with visual and continue, but no one makes a remark about having the runway in sight at the time of the minimum call out. They had descended below the minimum descent altitude without having the runway in sight. At this point, they were just hoping that the runway would appear in front of them in a few seconds. They only saw the runway a few seconds before touchdown. What frame of mind were the crew in as this landing was made? Pilots don't descend below the minimum descent altitude without having a visual on the runway. If you've watched this channel long enough, you'll know why. The flight was supposed to be 5 hours and 30 minutes long. Then, when they contacted Kathmandu, they learned that the weather was bad, and so they were in a holding pattern for about 15 more minutes. And then you can add the 15 minutes that it took for the first go-around to their flight time, and by the end, they had been on the job for more than 6.5 hours. They might have been fatigued, and so they weren't too keen on diverting. After the first missed approach, a cabin crew member asked the captain if he wanted to divert to Delhi, but he did not want to divert because that would be a, quote, "a big burden," end quote. Moreover, the captain was of the opinion that the weather was getting better, and so they'd be able to land there. As we saw earlier, the weather, in fact, was getting worse. The first officer tells the captain that the RNP approach would take them right to the runway. But we still have one last question. Why did the plane land on the edge of the runway? Well, you could explain it away with the fact that the pilots did not have a visual on the runway and thus mislanding the plane, but as it turns out, there's a deeper reason for this. Had it not been for a tiny error, this accident would not have happened, and we would not be talking about this today. As we've already said, the pilots were conducting an RNAV non-precision approach onto runway 02. This meant that the plane had to fly from waypoint to waypoint in order to line up with runway 02. This list of waypoints was stored on the plane's FMS or flight management system. At the end of this rather long list of waypoints is the GPS location of the runway threshold. The computer locks onto this and then flies the plane towards this location at the end of its RNAV approach. Digging back, they find that the airport had published an AIP or an aerodrome information publication on the 1st of January 2015. They were planning to maintain the runway, and as a part of this, the runway would be shifted 120 meters or 400 feet to the north. But the new coordinates that they gave for the new runway threshold was not on the center line. It was on, you guessed it, the left side of the runway. During this procedure, they mislabeled the position of the runway, and that's why the plane landed on the left shoulder of the runway. The FMS thought that it was the runway's center line. Another AIP was published to correct some errors in the first one. However, the incorrect runway coordinates were never corrected. But since the runway had not been changed, they issued a NOTAM, or a notice to airmen, asking everyone to disregard the AIP from the 4th of February to the 5th of February. After that, they put out another NOTAM that was in effect from the 5th of February to the 4th of March. Remember, the accident was on the 3rd of March. By the time the second NOTAM came out, the FMS on the plane had already been programmed with the incorrect runway coordinates. In fact, 2 days before the accident, a crew had sounded the alarm about this. Their plane was right where it should be as per the navigation system, but they were too high on approach. The airline just took too long to process their feedback. Moreover, had the pilots had a visual on the runway, they could have seen that they were not lined up and they could have fixed the issue. In the end, a crew that went past safe limits, paired with some corrupted data, caused the crash of Turkish Airlines Flight 726. Thank you for watching this episode of Mini Air Crash Investigation. If you like the videos that I make, do consider liking and subscribing. A big thank you to My Lost Airplane Fan for letting me use his amazing footage on my videos. I'll catch you guys next time. Stay safe, wash your hands.